Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of St James Ethics Centre, the Wheeler Centre, The Age, the ABC and the City of Melbourne, I welcome you here to the Melbourne Town Hall for the second debate in what's now the third season of Intelligence Squared debates being held here in Melbourne. Tonight we are gathered on the traditional lands of the Kulin Nation, and I wish to acknowledge them as the traditional owners. And I'd also like to pay my respects and that of the rest of us here to their elders and to the elders of other communities who may be here today. My name is Simon Longstaff. I'm the Executive Director of St James Ethics Centre, and I'm delighted to chair tonight's debate. I should mention that these debates are being recorded. They're being filmed for subsequent broadcast on the Wheeler Centre's website and then that of the Ethics Centre. And also tonight, this debate is being recorded by ABC Radio National Big Ideas. And I mention that to you because it may be that later on in the evening you'll choose to participate in the debate yourself when we have a floor debate. There will be some people who are tweeters, or tweebs as I'm told, in the audience. If you're inclined to do that tonight, then you can join the conversation with the hashtag IQ2Oz, that's IQ2OZ. There are some basic rules for the debate, which I think some of you will be familiar with. In terms of procedural issues, you will have found them outlined on the back of the order paper. But for those of you who are new to these debates, what we encourage you to do is to engage absolutely with passion about the ideas which might be at stake, but always with a respect for the intrinsic dignity of the people that you are opposing. Hopefully, as you came in tonight, you would have had your opinion about the topic recorded in a pre-debate poll, where you would have been asked to say whether you were for the motion, against, or undecided. Later on, when the speakers have had their chance to say what they believe about this issue, and when you've spoken yourselves as an audience, you'll be invited to vote more formally. And I'm hoping that you've all found on your chair a series of voting tickets with for and against. Don't tear them now, because if you're still undecided at the end of the debate, and I hope that none of you will be, then you just leave the ticket joined together and you cast that as an undecided vote. Otherwise, if you've made up your mind, tear away and put for or against according to how you think the matter ought to be decided. Now, the topic for tonight is that freedom of speech is overrated. And what I'm going to do now is to introduce those who are speaking for that motion as a group, and I'll ask you to welcome them when I've introduced all three speakers, and then I'll introduce those who are arguing against the proposition. So, speaking for the motion before this House, the first speaker is Professor Marcia Langton, who holds the Chair of Australian Indigenous Studies at the University of Melbourne. Marcia's doctoral fieldwork was conducted in Eastern Cape York Peninsula during the 1990s, and her experience of the statutory land claim and native title system in this region was informed by a decade of administration and fieldwork in the Northern Territory. She was awarded a PhD from Macquarie University in 2005. Professor Langton is a Fellow of the Academy of the Social Sciences of Australia, a member of the Australian Institute of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Studies, and is also chair of the Cape York Institute for Policy and Leadership. She's an editor of a new book, Community Futures, Legal Architecture, Foundations for Indigenous Peoples in the Global Mining Boom. Marcia is joined by Catherine Deveny, a comedy writer, columnist, stand-up comedian, and the author of Free to a Good Home, Say When, and It's Not My Fault, They Print Them. Catherine's television credits include Rove Live, Good News Week, Full Frontal and Skit House. She premiered her one-woman show, God is Bullshit, at the 2010 Melbourne International Comedy Festival and has previously written weekly opinion columns for The Age. She's a regular fill-in broadcaster on 774 ABC Melbourne and has appeared on ABC TV's Q&A in a number of different ways, actually, on Q&A, Network 10's 7pm project. Her seventh book and first novel, The Happiness Show, will be published in November by Black Ink Books. And finally, the third speaker for the affirmative is Michael Gawenda, a former editor-in-chief of The Age. He's a Walkley Award-winning journalist, columnist, and a former foreign correspondent. Currently, Michael is a Senior Research Fellow at the Centre for Advanced Journalism at the University of Melbourne. He's the author of American Notebook, A Personal and Political Journey, and Rocky and Gawenda, The Story of a Man and His Mutt. Would you please welcome the speakers for the motion? Now, to speak against this motion, the team for the negative is led by Arnold Zable, a writer, novelist, human rights advocate, and one of Australia's most loved storytellers. His award-winning books include Jewels and Ashes, The Fig Tree, and three novels, Café Scheherazade, Scraps of Heaven, and Sea of Many Returns. His most recent book is Violin Lessons. He's the author of numerous columns, stories and essays, and co-author of the play Kanyama Kan, in which asylum seekers tell their stories. Zable has lectured and run workshops on creative writing and human rights issues throughout Australia. He's president of the Melbourne Centre of International Pen, and I suppose for that we should have an empty chair here on the stage in acknowledgement of all of those authors who are imprisoned for their work. He has a doctorate from the School of Creative Arts, Melbourne University, where he was recently appointed a Vice-Chancellor's Fellow. He's joined by Gretel Killeen, a writer, performer, voice artist and journalist. She's currently completing her directorial feature film debut. Known to many as the host of one of Australia's history-making television shows, she's also a best-selling author, journalist and humorist. She's directed documentaries in Africa and India. She's been a travel writer in Namibia, Lebanon and Antarctica, and performed in the war zones of Afghanistan and Iraq, amongst others. Gretel is a single mum and is currently completing writing and directing her first feature film, Jimmy and Gret Don't Do Sex. And finally, the third speaker for the negative is Julian Burnside QC, an Australian barrister who specialises in commercial litigation and is also deeply involved in human rights work, in particular in relation to refugees. He is a former president of Liberty Victoria and is also passionately involved in the arts. He's the chair of Melbourne Arts Venue, 45 downstairs, and is chair of the Mieta Foundation. Julian is also a writer who's published a children's book, Matilda and the Dragon, as well as Word Watching, a collection of essays on the uses and abuses of the English language, and Watching Brief, reflections on human rights, law and justice. He's also the editor of From Nothing to Zero, a compilation of letters written by asylum seekers held in Australia's detention camps. Would you please welcome the speakers from the media? Ladies and gentlemen, the proposition before this House is that freedom of speech is overrated. I now invite Marcia Langton to address this House with her arguments for the affirmative. Marcia.
Thank you, Simon. I acknowledge the Wurundjeri traditional owners. My name is Marcia Langton and I'm the first speaker for the affirmative. Freedom of speech, is it overrated? Yes. Let me explain why. I'll give you some examples, first of all, of why you would want freedom of speech limited and why you would say that, well, yes, there must be limits to freedom of speech and the rhetoric of freedom of speech should be tempered with some intelligent qualifications. Tobacco advertising, claims made about new products such as weight loss tea, advertising laws, defamation, slander, libel, internet threats and stalking, internet bullying, national security, anti-terror measures, child pornography, hate laws, racial vilification. But let's look at this idea of freedom of speech. It is, first of all, a right to freedom of opinion, and that is essentially a private right. Only after that is it a right to freedom of expression. So it's the case in Australia, for instance, that we actually do not have freedom of speech or freedom of expression expressed in our constitution, except in a limited implied way, and there's some case law on it. And indeed, it's very clear that in Australia, it's very clear that the law says that we can't have freedom of expression on, say, polling day, so there can be no political advertising on polling day. So, you know, there's a direct limit to the freedom of speech of people running for parliaments. Let's just go back in time to the era when this idea of freedom of expression was first countenanced. So during the Enlightenment, during the 18th century, modern thinkers began to think about human rights, and in the United States of America, the First Amendment is an expression of that thinking. And I fear that in the Australian context, with our young people watching so much American television, they hear about the First Amendment constantly and they think there's such a thing in Australia. I'll just read it out. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. So that First Amendment in the United States of America is clearly a statement of individual rights and offers protection against the violation of those rights by government, i.e. Congress. But its full elements go unnoticed today, and that is that it mentions religion first, and it rejects an official establishment of any one religion, while protecting the practice of all religions. But it notably protects citizens in their private religious rights from the interference of government. And so freedom of speech and freedom of the press are secondary to that freedom of religion expressed in the First Amendment. And so freedom of speech and freedom of the press are twin rights, if you like, that follow in that Enlightenment thinking from the great value placed on the freedom of religion in America especially, because of the persecution of certain sects. But this is not the case in Australia, where we have no Bill of Rights. And this is very meaningful for the way that we think about freedom of expression in Australia, because what is referred to as American exceptionalism, founded in ideas of liberty, are very different from our situation in Australia, in which the idea of human rights and the idea of freedom of speech is much more recent and developing still, after only about 30 years of law, stated rights and so on. So we have a limited constitutional protection for political speech in Australia, but we do not have a legal right to free expression. And yet, despite that, the importance of the right of freedom of speech is accepted by Australian society. I have no doubt about that. But this rhetoric of free speech has been used to justify all kinds of harm to others, or potential harm to others. And so, therefore, one must think about the kinds of limits that most of us would accept as normal to the right of freedom of expression. And, you know, it starts at the dinner table when we teach youngsters, don't say that to your brother, that's not very nice. Don't say that to your sister, that's not very nice. So we first of all think about the harm that might be done to others. We think about the rights of others, and we do that instinctively, for instance, in the way that we raise children. So therefore, it shouldn't be a surprise that under the Racial Hatred Act, it is an offence to insult, humiliate, offend or intimidate another person or group in public on the basis of their race. It's perfectly all right to have those thoughts in private, but once you make them public, then a law has been broken. And that's the point about freedom of speech in our country. Freedom of speech is a right that can be protected in some ways if there is a law that protects it or limits it. If a law limits it, then the law is necessarily stating that such a right exists, I think. I think that's just logical. And so, for instance, with racial hatred laws and Section 18 of the Racial Discrimination Act, which became so famous with the Blomberg decision in Etock v. Bolt and the Herald Sun, we can be assured that our laws are really much more on our side, that is, those of us who enjoy the freedom of speech, than people who want to remove Section 18D of the Racial Discrimination Act would have it. So, for instance, none of these laws provide for the censorship of an artistic work that expresses racism, for instance. And there's great leniency towards the media so long as there is evidence, so long as the facts are presented. The media can make statements in the public interest about all sorts of things, including race matters, so long as there is evidence. So the media is given considerable scope. And I think the bell has rung. So, yes, it's overrated, especially in Australia, and I hope that our young people will learn what it is in Australia to have freedom of speech.
Arnold Zable.
I acknowledge the Wurundjeri on whose land we stand. Towards the end of each year, the members of the Melbourne Centre of PEN International meet to write cards to persecuted writers worldwide. Unlike our year-long advocacy work, on this occasion, we simply send messages wishing imprisoned writers all the best for the new year. Our aim is to simply let them know you are not alone. In December 2006, we sent a card to Armenian-Turkish journalist Fran Dink. As editor and founder of Argos, a journal that sought recognition of the Armenian genocide and advocated the human rights of ethnic minorities in Turkey, Fran Dink had received death threats and had been arraigned under the Turkish Penal Code on the charge of insulting Turkishness. He faced imprisonment if found guilty. 4 months later, in April 2007, we received a card that Dink had written in reply. But by then, we had long known that on January 19, Hrant Dink had been gunned down as he was leaving his Istanbul office. Due to the vagaries of the mail, or for more sinister reasons, the reply had arrived months after his death. He would have written it just days before his murder. Hrant Dink was assassinated for the peaceful expression of his views. As someone who has been an active member of the Melbourne Centre of International PEN for almost two decades, I know all too well that freedom of speech is not overrated, but actually held in utter contempt by many political leaders, authorities and vested interests in all too many countries. To see how things really are right now as we speak, we need only go to Penn International's weekly online roundup. Reading from the latest roundup, May 1st, 2012, Penn International's Writers in Prison Committee reiterates its protest at the continued detention of academic, blogger and human rights activist Dr. Abdul-Jal al-Singachi and human rights defender Abdul-Hadi al-Khawaja and urges a full and independent investigation into allegations that they were tortured in pre-trial detention. Penn continues to call for the immediate and unconditional release of all those currently detained in Bahrain for the peaceful exercise of their opinions. May 2nd, 2012. The Writers in Prison Committee of Penn International is appalled by the recent murder of veteran Mexican journalist Regina Martinez. Martinez, a correspondent for the investigative news magazine Proceso, was found dead at her home in Veracruz State on the 28th of April 2012. She had been badly beaten and strangled. Martinez had been investigating and writing about drug trafficking and organized crime. On and on it goes, case after case, year after year, week after week, we receive notice of cases of writers who have been harassed, beaten, kidnapped, threatened, imprisoned, tortured, exiled, and even murdered for the peaceful practice of their vocation. They are persecuted by political regimes across the spectrum, from right to left, from totalitarian to Islamist, from military junta's to self-proclaimed democracies. At any one time, there are upwards of 900 writers, journalists, bloggers, and so on, in over 90 countries on Penn's case lists. Now, International Penn has long understood the grave threats to freedom of expression since its formation in 1921. A few telling examples. In 1933, Penn's president, H.G. Wells, led a campaign against the burning of books in Germany. At a time when critical comments from the international community about the actions of the Nazi Party were still scarce. In the 1960s, Penn joined a campaign protesting the Soviet invasion of Czechoslovakia and in support of the many writers and activists who were persecuted for defending the Prague Spring as the Czech uprising against totalitarianism was known. In the late 1980s and 90s, Penn played a prominent role in calling for the rescinding of Ayatollah Khomeini's fatwa against Salman Rushdie and his publishers for the publication of his novel Satanic Verses. Since 2006, International Penn has highlighted the death of Russian journalist and human rights activist Anna Politkovskaya. Anna was murdered on the 7th of October 2006 for her courageous reporting of Russian abuses in Chechnya and her devastating critique of Vladimir Putin and his cronies. She was shot and killed in the lift of her block of flats. In December 2008, Penn protested against the Chinese government's crackdown on its citizens' right to freedom of expression. And it was interesting. The crackdown took place just as after the Olympic Games ended. China was no longer flavour of the month. The international press had left. Very few people gave a damn. And as part of that crackdown, Chinese writer Liu Xiaobo was arrested for his role in publishing Charter 08, a document calling for political reform that the 302 co-signers planned to release 2 days later on International Human Rights Day. The document now has over 10,000 signatures from all over China, many of whom have suffered reprisals. Liu remains in prison even after being awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2010. His award was presented to an empty chair. In January this year, International Penn led a delegation to Mexico, protesting the death since the year 2000 of at least 67 journalists, writers and bloggers murdered in connection to their work. They were targeted for exposing gross violations of human rights, corruption, extortion and rampant dealings by drug syndicates. There is a caveat. I agree with Marcia on this issue, that pen and panellists always recognise that there are limits to freedom of expression. And in our charter, in Article 4 of our charter, we express the following, that since freedom implies voluntary restraint, members pledge themselves to oppose such evils of a free press as mendacious publication, deliberate falsehood and distortion of facts for political and personal ends. I thought what Andrew Bolt wrote was absolutely outrageous because he didn't even get the facts right. He lied and he distorted. However, this is not a debate about the limits of freedom of speech, but a debate on whether freedom of speech is overrated. To reiterate, years of membership of PEN have taught me over and again that freedom of speech is precious, it can be easily taken for granted, it needs to be nurtured and protected, it needs to be highly rated. Otherwise, not only will it lead to tragic consequences for many courageous writers and human rights activists, but the world's precious literary and creative heritage would be seriously compromised. Now, last December, we gathered as usual to write our annual cards. In February, we received a reply from imprisoned Turkish writer Recep Zarakoğlu, an ardent defender of the freedom to write and publish. "Dear members of Melbourne PEN Centre," he wrote, "first of all, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. Thank you for your cards, dear Paddy, dear Jackie, dear Robert. Greetings to you from High Security Special Crimes Prison. I am going to write, I am going to think, to read, so I am the most free person. This card is of our capital, Ankara. It was a special place of exile for writers in 1915. Special thanks for Angela for the paintings. Best wishes, Recep Zarakoğlu." Due to the efforts partly of International PEN, he was recently released, but many others remain imprisoned. Thank you.
Catherine Deveny.
Is freedom of speech overrated? The claim we actually have freedom of speech, as opposed to a perception of freedom of speech, an illusion, is not only ludicrous, but deeply offensive to those with the inability to exercise freedom of speech, which is most of us. The threat of negative consequences, be they legal, economic, social, or emotional, compounded by the oppression of the illusion of the enshrined right to free speech, or in the case of Australia, the implied right to free speech, makes freedom of speech for all a perception, not a reality. Select people have the right to say some things some of the time without the threat of negative consequences. Look in the mirror. If you are a rich, white, middle-aged, middle-class, straight or straight-acting, God-fearing or pretending man with disproportionate access to power, control, decision-making, leisure and money, you are almost certain to be one of these select people. If you are a woman, gay, atheist, an activist for disability rights, action on climate change, the rights of the asylum seekers, etc., you can look forward to a life of being undermined with microaggression at best and being gagged at worst. Let me illustrate. Men have opinions. Women are opinionated. Men speak. Women are outspoken. Men are passionate. Women are strident. Men have mouths. Women are mouthy. How could we discuss freedom of speech without mentioning the Leadership Conference of Women Religious? The LCWR is the largest organisation of nuns in the United States. The Vatican recently found the nuns' organisation had radical feminist tendencies. and has appointed an archbishop to get the nuns to heal. The Vatican did an inquiry into the LCWR and found the nuns spent too much time supporting programs like homelessness and healthcare and had not taken a strong enough stance against women's ordination, gay marriage, abortion and contraception. A spokesperson for the Catholic Church said, "Occasional public statements by the LCWR disagree or challenge positions taken by the bishops, who are the Church's authentic teachers of faith and morals. Some people can say some things some of the time." Still in the US, the New York City Department of Education is currently seeking to have words they deem upsetting removed from tests in schools, fearing that certain words and topics can make students feel unpleasant. Officials are requesting 50 or so words be removed from the tests. One of the words is dinosaur. The word dinosaur made the hit list because dinosaurs suggest evolution, which may offend creationists. Halloween, because it suggests paganism. Birthday, because birthdays aren't celebrated by Jehovah's Witnesses. Also banned are divorce and disease, because kids taking tests may have relatives who have split or spouses who are ill. Other words, celebrities, loss of employment, and in-depth discussion of sports that require prior knowledge. Now let's talk blasphemy. There are people who equate freedom of speech with immunity from criticism. The United Nations has accepted several non-binding resolutions condemning defamation of religion, despite the fact that blasphemy is a victimless crime and that offence is a healthy byproduct of free speech. More damage is caused by taking offence than giving offence. And no one has the right not to be offended, not even Cardinal George Pell. Let's take Andrew Bolt. He's a rather opinionated, outspoken, strident and mouthy columnist for a Melbourne tabloid who lost a racial discrimination case last year. You may have heard of him. Bolt lamented his gagging the following day on the front page of Australia's highest circulating newspaper in a lengthy piece and continued to rail against his silencing on radio and television that week, and continues to on his radio show and television show. It helps him heal, people. The judgment by Justice Mordecai Bromberg included this paragraph, which really stood out. "Language of that kind has a heightened capacity to convey implications beyond the literal meanings of the words utilised. It's language which invites the reader not only to read the lines, but also to read between the lines." Now, at the time, the Institute of Public Affairs took out a full-page ad in the Australian newspaper claiming Australia's freedom of speech was under threat. They also set up a website which still exists called supportbolt.com. The IPA was very fast to support freedom of speech when it came to someone who was a mouthpiece for their agenda. I'm yet to see them support free speech when it comes to someone they disagree with, perhaps someone questioning who they are funded by. Unlike the IPA, I support free speech, even when I don't like what is being said. In Australia, the illusion of free speech is staggering. Take our defamation laws. In theory, the objective of defamation laws is to balance protecting the individual's reputation within freedom of expression. In practice, defamation laws are frequently used as means of gagging people and halting public discourse. The threat of costly defamation proceedings, whether the claim is likely to be upheld by a court or not, is often used to silence criticism, not only by a particular personal group, but also as a threat to others. We may all be equal in the eyes of the law, but we are not all equal in the eyes of the bank. But what about laggers? We've all seen Prisoner. We all know what happens to laggers. They get their hands put in the press. Whistleblowers, squealers, leakers and laggers are considered the lowest of the low in Australia. Despite a 2007 federal government pledge to reforms to restore trust and integrity in government, more than 500 secrecy clauses, which effectively criminalise the release of government information, remain in place. Some people are allowed to say some things some of the time. Which leads me to Julian Assange. Our Prime Minister Julia Gillard copped a bucket load from within her party for failing to support Assange after calling WikiLeaks an illegal act and suggesting that Assange's Australian passport should be cancelled. Hundreds of lawyers, academics and journalists came forward in his support, with her own Attorney General unable to explain how Assange had broken Australian law. WikiLeaks was, and still is, widely criticised in the media for doing exactly the same as what the Fairfax and Murdoch papers do every single day. Jemima Khan, who provided surety to Julian Assange at his London hearing, said, "The best justification governments can find to shut down information is that lives are at risk. In fact, lives have been at risk as a result of the silences and lies revealed in these leaks." There are middle-aged, middle-class white men like Kyle Sanderlands, Jason Ackermanis, Sam Newman, Andrew Bolt or Steve Price who suffer from freedom of too much speech. But how free do the rich, white, middle-aged, middle-class, straight or straight-acting, God-fearing or pretending men really feel to speak? How free do they feel to say, "I'm scared, I'm gay, I'm an atheist, I hate my job, I feel like a corporate maggot, I think I'm an alcoholic, or I may be suffering depression"? How free do they feel to say that? Freedom of speech is all a brilliant concept, but that's all it is, a concept, a perception, an illusion, and an overrated one at that.
Gretel Killeen.
Thank you. And thank you, Catherine. I completely and utterly agree. In arguing that freedom of speech is pretty much non-existent, you've argued our case. That freedom of speech is not overrated. It's actually kind of not rated enough. Now, one of the issues that was raised last week would allow for some of the confusion over our definition of the value of freedom of speech. Only last week, a British woman confessed to racially harassing a fellow tube passenger. You familiar with this story? That is, she was abusing her freedom of speech. Interestingly, however, as offensive as her diatribe was, which was captured on a video, an extract of that diatribe is readily available on news websites throughout the world. The expletives are deleted, but the sentiment is as clear as day. So a woman is prosecuted for expressing her offensive thoughts, but a newspaper outlet employs freedom of speech to distribute the essence of the very same vitriol. No wonder we're confused. It would appear that freedom of speech can be compromised and abused. In our society, freedom of speech can be trivialised, unexplored, taken for granted, and abandoned. Does this mean it's overrated? You know, sometimes in our society, we don't even know when someone is expressing their freedom of speech. Sometimes freedom of speech is unrecognised, even by the speaker. I was walking through Sydney the other day, down in the Housing Commission area, and a man called out to me, "G'day, slag." I did think, well, I won't be wearing this outfit again. And as I walked on, I thought, well, that'll be it. But he followed me. There's a big expressway. Being a typical Sydney-sider, I, of course, ignore all traffic signs and do as I wish. I decided to cross. Well, unbeknownst to me, this man, who was dressed in rags and appeared to be a little drunk, followed me across the road. Well, it was four lanes. I managed to dash across, and I turned around and saw this bloke ambling along behind me. So I thought, well, I better go save his life and be a human shield. So I ran back, got him, saved his life, protected him from the oncoming traffic, and when we got to the other side, he said, "Thanks, slag." Was that freedom of speech? Was he making a political comment? Or did I just remind him of his wife? Freedom of speech is not simply the right to express what is considered to be political ideology, but also our personal politics, our ideals, our dreams, our values, our passions, our philosophy, and of course often our religion. Freedom of speech is the right to the expression of all that makes us who we are. Let me share with you some text messages I received from my daughter from the age of 10 to 14. "I love you more than the world can imagine and you can do anything." She spelt U-E-W-E. "I love you unbelievably much. I love you more than the heart can hold. You are wonderful and I hope everything is great, and remember I'm always here for you. I am in pain. Mum, this sucks. How can I grow up to be a normal person with you as a role model?" She sent me that one after I asked her to put a load of washing in the dryer. "And finally, if you want to come into my room, send me an email first." Now, I, of course, thought this expression to be both amusing and rude. In my opinion, it achieved nothing and was unnecessary. My daughter, however, thought she'd made a profound political statement and re-established the balance of power in her bedroom. I considered this to be somewhat overrating, which begs the question, whose judgment of freedom of speech is superior? The speaker, or shall we say, the listener, assuming they're listening at all? When considering the subject that freedom of speech is overrated, we have no choice but to contemplate, overrated by whom? The one who is speaking or the one who could be listening? Let's look at it from the perspective of the listener. It's unfortunately often the privileged who cannot see the value in something others treasure. Perhaps freedom of speech is considered overrated by those who already have this freedom. Perhaps they consider it overrated because, in their opinion, the reward is not worth the effort. So why then do people make the effort? When we look at people across the world who have valiantly fought for freedom of speech and won, we can easily understand why they've made the effort. Aung San Suu Kyi and Nelson Mandela. But what about those who do not appear to have been successful at all? In Laos, I met a man who was suffering with AIDS, HIV at the time, his wife and their child, 1 year old. This man had lost his job. He fought for the right to work. The result of that was that he was ostracized, not only himself, his family, his wife and child, but his parents, his grandparents, all of their siblings. I've met people in the same region who've lost limbs to unexploded ordnance. They've spoken out because they were US bombs. I'm not sure if you're familiar, but not only were mines planted, but bombs were often deposited in the jungle areas there when the planes were flying back to base. But there were also these little bombs. I don't know if you've ever seen them. They look like a piece of fruit, and they're designed to look like a piece of fruit. They're yellow. You can't tell the difference, really, between it and an orange until you pick it up and it explodes. Well, what happened to those people? I saw them. They'd lost limbs, and they'd fought to be heard to get some sort of compensation from the US government. The result was that they were heartbreakingly ignored. They failed. I don't know if you've ever seen someone who's been burnt with acid. I have. I've seen a home full of them in Bangladesh. Why? Because in Bangladesh, women are supposed to accept the proposal in this particular area of any man who proposed to them. If you don't, you can expect revenge. Often the females will share the same bed. Obviously it's not a bed, it's you sleep on the floor on a mat. With your mum, with your siblings, if you have children, they'll be in there too. It is not uncommon for 12 and 13 year old girls to decline someone's hand in marriage and then face the consequences. For example, having acid poured over you in the middle of the night. Not only you, but your children and your mum. I don't know if you've ever seen it, as I say, but acid doesn't just burn your skin, it burns your bone. These faces have melted. Why would any of these people pursue freedom of speech knowing the risks they were taking? Why would you do that? Because quite simply, to them, the risk was worth the taking. To do otherwise was not an option. I know that some people here don't value freedom of speech. I know people gleefully send irresponsible, hurtful twitters. I myself have been the recipient of much pain in that department. I know people take shortcuts in their communications because they don't treasure the actual opportunity to express themselves. You've all heard of LOL, which presumably in a text means laugh out loud. No. A friend of mine sent it to someone and did it incorrectly. He'd learnt that it means lots of love. He sent it to someone and their dog had died. Lots of love. They interpreted it as laugh out loud. The current Murdoch media debate has proven to us that we're happy to pass on the responsibility of our freedom to someone perhaps not at all qualified. Freedom of speech can be underutilised, abused, abandoned, trivialised. But that doesn't actually make it overrated. Perhaps those who say freedom of speech is overrated have simply forgotten the value of true freedom of speech, because they have the luxury of enjoying it. In the same way many girls of today take their right to vote, to dress the way they want, to work, to have both control, they take it for granted. Do they have to meet the women that I have met in Afghanistan and Iraq, the value of whose lives is less than a chicken when it comes to compensation should an accident occur? For those who wish to speak, freedom of speech is perfectly valued. I would go so far as to suggest that freedom of speech is not overrated, but our ability to listen may well be. Thank you.
Michael Gawenda.
Thank you. I thought I would have total freedom of speech tonight, and so I've prepared a speech that's about 2 hours long. But apparently freedom of speech is limited here tonight to 9 minutes. Now, as Simon said before, I was editor of The Age for 7 years. Some of you here might think more's the pity, but I was. And I'll tell you this, what I realised in those 7 years, one of the things I realised, lots of things, but one of the things I realised was that many people have a view of the world that is almost entirely non-fact-based. I suppose they are true postmodernists. My days were filled with complaints from 9/11 deniers, anti-fluoride crazies, world government alarmists, and strangely enough, the world government was always in a bunker in Canberra, which I thought was really interesting. Why would a world government be in a bunker in Canberra? And I sometimes asked them that question, but they thought, as soon as I asked that question, I'm part of the conspiracy. And all sorts of other non-fact-based views of the world. And what were they contacting me for? They were contacting me for to say that I was limiting their right to freedom of speech. For all my talk publicly, and I often did this, said that we journalists, we editors, we're basically defenders of freedom of speech. We're in the business of freedom of speech. We're in the business of disclosing. The fact was that a lot of the time I was a censor. I was a denier of freedom of speech, and I was certainly a denier of freedom of speech to some of the sort of people I mentioned. They made my life miserable, and I made their life miserable as well, maybe even more so. Now, I don't think my making their life miserable deserved the sort of threats I sometimes received. But I was quite amused by some of the threats, which, and they must have, some of them must have been, I'm going to mention a conspiracy here, being in touch with each other and sending me these threats together. And one of the threats was that I should be damned to hell and in hell be forever damned to editing The Age. So I was a hypocrite. I accept that. I talked about freedom of speech, and at the same time I stopped all these people from having their freedom of speech. And there were, and there are, I'm no longer in the censoring business, but there are now, there are editors and news directors and all sorts of people that control the flow of information who are basically in the business of censoring, of deciding what they're going to publish and what they're not going to publish. I tried not to publish things that I knew not to be factually accurate. But there were also things that I refused to publish that I thought were, I suppose racism isn't factually accurate or factually based. Racism, things that, but in the main they were things, Holocaust deniers, people who saw the world in a way that I couldn't accept was factually based. And there are people out there that are doing this sort of work every day, and they're limiting free speech in all sorts of ways that go beyond what I said, that are limiting it for all sorts of reasons that you might think are not appropriate. By the way, I hope there aren't too many 9/11 conspiracy deniers here tonight. If there are, don't write to me, write to the editor of The Age. But the fact is that not only do the people that I've just mentioned not believe in freedom of speech, really, they censor people, but I think most of us don't actually believe in freedom of speech. What we actually support, is speech that somehow reflects our views, speech that we think is appropriate, speech that we think is within the bounds of community standards, however loosely those community standards are defined. And then the fact is also that, somebody mentioned this, it's true, freedom of speech in any sort of society like ours goes more to people that have power than people who are powerless. That's absolutely true. I mean, who would listen to anything that Clive Palmer had to say? Why would you publish anything that Clive Palmer has to say? I mean, imagine some Joe Blow off the street came along and wrote a piece and said that the Greens were funded by the CIA. Would that be published? It would never be published. It's published because Clive Palmer has $8 billion and is still counting. He can buy freedom of speech, he can buy influence. So I believe that, and I want to acknowledge that, of course, in some societies, there are people whose lives are taken because they say things. And that's not a good thing. That's a terrible thing. And we shouldn't forget that, at least in our society, people's lives aren't taken for saying things that we disagree with. But what does happen in our society is that, in the main, people aren't allowed to say things that are going to offend and upset and enrage people. And who makes a judgment on what is offensive and what is upsetting? How do you define these limits? I think most people define them in terms of what they actually support and what they don't support. Now, somebody mentioned Andrew Bolt just a minute ago. I think Andrew Bolt's two columns were absolutely appalling. I would not have published them if I was editing the Herald Sun. God forbid that ever happened. But I would not have published those columns. And the reason I wouldn't have published those columns are twofold. One, that they were factually inaccurate, and I would have hoped that I would have seen, or my sub-editors or my opinion editor would have seen, that there were factual issues with these columns and that therefore they shouldn't have been published. But I also wouldn't have published them because, in my personal opinion, and I've got a right to have that opinion, and I've got a right to censor him, I didn't like the tone of those columns. But I do think, at the same time, that it was disturbing that a judge found the tone of the columns to be offensive, and that that was one of the main reasons why the columns weren't published. I would have thought that all those defenders of freedom of speech, and there are many of them, some of them are sitting over there, should have been out there saying this is outrageous. That part of the judgment is outrageous. Speech, free speech to have any real meaning has to be offensive. You have to accept that there will be offensive free speech. Now, Voltaire said, or I think he said, I read it on Google, I passionately disagree with what you say, but I will defend to the death your right to say it. Well, that's just bullshit, isn't it? I mean, the fact is none of us on this side, would passionately defend to the death the right to, for someone to say something that they totally disagree with. It's not true, is it? Because the fact is we don't really believe in free speech. We don't really believe in free speech, and everything about the way our society operates tells us that. So is it overrated? Of course it's overrated. Thank you.
Julian Burnside.
Salman Rushdie said, "You keep the freedoms that you fight for. You lose the freedoms that you neglect. Freedom is something that somebody's always trying to take away from you, and if you don't defend it, you will lose it." The affirmative team say that freedom of speech is overrated. I actually don't think they believe it. And listening to their speeches, they really didn't put up an argument for it. They did give some examples which fall outside freedom of speech. Now, clearly, all freedoms have limits. As one law lecturer told me years ago, your freedom to swing your arm stops just short of my nose. Understandable. The limits to free speech are well known, and they've been well known for a long time. When Andrew Bolt published that notorious column calling Pat Eatock and Larissa Berendt and others white Aborigines, it was not an exercise of free speech. It was an abuse which went beyond the limits of free speech. Freedom of speech does not allow you to falsely shout fire in a crowded cinema. Lying is not protected by freedom of speech. Hate speech is not protected by freedom of speech. And we agree with the affirmative team on precisely that. What they have done is to put forward examples of the abuse of free speech, but that can't prove the proposition that freedom of speech is overrated. All it does is to prove that some people who abuse their ability to speech fall back on the right of free speech as an excuse for their own bad conduct. You shouldn't decide this debate on the sort of bad examples that you've been given by the affirmative. Now, Catherine gave some terrific examples of circumstances where free speech has been suppressed, and that's the area where you find the true value of freedom of speech. History offers lots of examples where the real importance of free speech has been illustrated by its suppression. Galileo was hauled before the Inquisition because he put forward the view, based on careful observation of the phases of Venus, that the sun did not move and that the earth moved around the sun. He spent the rest of his life under house arrest because that proposition, although it was true, was apparently contradicted by a single sentence in one book of the Old Testament. And it took until the 20th century for the Vatican to apologise to him. Not that that must have been any comfort to him. Salman Rushdie was the subject of a fatwa for about a decade as a result of expressing views that were regarded as heretical by some fanatical mullahs. Alexander Solzhenitsyn was exiled in 1974 for writing the truth about the Russian gulags. In 1942 and 1943, a small group of students at Munich University, not well enough remembered these days, calling themselves the White Rose Movement, distributed seven leaflets in Munich urging German people to oppose the tyranny of Nazism and to oppose a futile war. Members of the White Rose, all of them, were caught by the Gestapo, and significantly, when they were put to death, they were put to death by being beheaded. They, however, although they ultimately paid the ultimate price for expressing truths which were unpopular, they have inspired many people since then, people who've spoken out against government tyranny, against senseless war. They knew, and the people who follow them knew, that free speech might be dangerous, but it is not overrated. But we don't need to go very far afield to see examples of the importance of free speech. I greatly admire each member of the affirmative team. Each one of them in their life's work has shown just how valuable free speech is. Michael, as editor of The Age, the only real newspaper we have these days, won three Walkley Awards for writing frankly about important subjects. Catherine Deveny took on Cardinal Pell at the Sydney Festival of Dangerous Ideas on the issue of abortion. That's a stoush that not many people are willing to take on. She had the honour and distinction of being banned by the Catholic Church from speaking on International Women's Day in a basketball court at Mildura, which happened to be owned by the Catholic Church. And now, Cardinal Pell is threatening to sue her for defamation because she passed on an image of him which accurately quoted five words spoken by him on Q&A. She had a comedy show you've heard about called God is Bullshit in the Melbourne Comedy Festival in 2010. It was a perfect example of freedom of speech in action, and the more so because it was designed to challenge comfortable views. She got sacked from The Age for a tweet. Now, it's easy to think of Twitter as a trivial exercise, but she was making a non-trivial point about celebrity raunch culture and the objectification of women. I admire someone who is willing to put themselves on the line like that. Catherine is a living illustration of the value of freedom of speech. Marcia has spoken out fearlessly against the ALP, the Greens, the Queensland government, about the Wild Rivers laws. She's written about the general incompetence that afflicts Darwin and has even identified moral confusion in the Aboriginal community. She's called Germaine Greer a racist. These are things that can make you unpopular. We're so wedded in Australia to orthodox views that when a person stands up and says something that's new or different or unpopular or previously unthought, we're shocked. Free speech, of course, can bring change, and that's part of its value, but it can also bring discomfort. Free speech at its best is likely to disturb the complacent and irritate the powerful. That's why it is important. And the powerful and the complacent are the very ones who benefit from things staying the way they are. They resent the possibility of new ideas circulating in the community because, coupled with freedom of thought, as Marcia pointed out, comes freedom of speech. Freedom of thought without the freedom to express those thoughts is meaningless. To be free to think whatever you want and not be free to give voice to those thoughts would be to live in a prison without bars. We really need to applaud Michael and Catherine and Marcia for their courage over the years in showing us by their living example how important free speech is. And on that vein, can I urge you to have a look at www.catherinedeveny.com. It's .au? Just .com. It's fantastic. It's fantastic. There is an example of free speech in action. Those who would deny your freedom of speech will first try to persuade you that it's overrated. They will try to persuade you that it's not worth it. You should not fall for that trick. I admire the members of the affirmative team because they are living examples of the value of free speech. But that doesn't mean they should win the debate tonight. Quite the contrary. Quite the contrary. In all seriousness, a vote for them dishonours the very thing they stand for. A vote for the affirmative dishonours what they have done with their lives. It dishonours the things they fight for and the very thing they put into action. A vote for our team, on the other hand, is what you need to give because it honours the affirmative team. Thank you.
The old seducer at work. But I have to remain independent. Ladies and gentlemen, there's now an opportunity for you to participate in this debate. You can speak for the motion, you can speak against it, you might have a question where you seek clarification or a comment. Whatever it is, I'd ask you to speak from one of two microphones. You'll see a gentleman there holding one and another in this aisle here. And just a procedural thing, if you could say your name, and then you have up to a minute to speak for or against or to ask your question. I'd encourage you, as I mentioned before, to be respectful in the way that you might challenge some of the ideas that you've heard. And then after that, you'll have those ballot forms to be cast in a vote which will resolve the matter in terms of which side of the argument has won. So is anybody who'd like to speak for the motion that freedom of speech is overrated? Yes? Okay. Would you like to come forward?
Hi, Gordon Young. Thank you, everyone. That was amazing. Now, there's an article up on the St. James Ethics website at the moment that suggests that freedom of speech isn't actually what you want to achieve the things you described that it would achieve, but rather accountability of speech would do that, whereby you can say whatever you want, but if you're challenged and you can't produce evidence to back it up, you should issue an apology. I'd just like the negative side's views on that.
I think it's a very interesting idea and a good idea. But it would not replace the existing recognised limits to free speech. I mean, clearly you should not allow lies, and that's really all that proposition is directed to. But equally, I don't think freedom of speech should be used as a cover for hate speech and seriously defamatory statements. So, yeah, it's a useful idea.
To go back to Michael's point, would you therefore expect an editor to head off a lie at the pass that it should not be published at all?
I don't think it's at all useful to have a responsible newspaper reproducing things which are known to be untrue.
And the issue of tone, should an editor rather than a court again exercise that editorial decision and say, I will not publish that because I do not approve of its tone?
Yes, I think that's a responsible thing to do because in the tone you adopt, you may effectively communicate the opposite of what the words say.
Okay. Somebody who'd like to speak against the motion, in other words, on this side. Is there anybody who would like to do that? Yes, please just come forward. If you can just wait in line if you want to, you can have your chance. We'll go there, but we'll do it in that kind of order. So, are you speaking against the motion?
I think so. I'm not sure.
Okay. Well, let's see. Your name, please.
Don Hampshire from Sunbury. The first speaker criticised the fact that freedom of speech is not in the Constitution. The Constitution was simply a contract that transferred certain responsibilities from the states to the new government, which they felt was could be handled better by it. And defamation was not one of those. It was in the hands of the states, and it remains in the hands of the states. My wife migrated here with a copy of the Salford University rag, which had a funny in it about laws in different countries, and it began, "In Britain, everything is permitted except what is forbidden." And that's the same in Australia. And I'm quite happy not to have a law that defines what I'm allowed to say, but I'm equally happy to have a law that says what I'm not allowed to say, as long as it's only a few little things.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to see if somebody wants to speak for the motion. Is there someone here who wants to do that? Yes?
I actually have a question, please. I'm not quite sure whether it's for or against. It's a practical application in our Australian society of freedom of speech rights. And it relates to people in the employment situation who are being sacked for speaking the truth. And there's been two recent cases in 2011. One was a young man who Facebooked some comments about his employment at local government and said they never give us enough money to do the job. And the other one was another local government example where somebody responded to a question about how are you finding it working there, and the response was, well, you know, it's hierarchical and siloed and it's a different decision-making process to the one I'm used to. Both were dismissed, stripped of their jobs and their reputations, and dismissed for serious misconduct, which is usually a charge that's associated with fraud, embezzlement, acts of violence, etc. My question to anyone who cares to answer it is, how are workers' rights to freedom of speech protected, and by whom?
Okay. I might come to you. I suspect you're the best qualified to answer that, Julian. So,
the protection is in the Whistleblowers Protection Act, and it is not adequate.
And that it, just do you want to explain a little bit, because it's limited the cases to which protection is accorded. It's to do with when you make a serious complaint of wrongdoing or some kind, rather than it wouldn't be protected if you simply say, "I don't like this place and how it works."
No. But what it does is protect certain protected disclosures. I don't think it goes far enough. I'm not sure the administration of it goes far enough. But it's really difficult to talk about these things in the abstract, because there's always two sides to what was actually going on. That's all I can say. I think they're not adequately protected, though.
Okay, we'll take next person, please. Your name and...
My name's McKinley, and again, it's just a question, really. So I 100% agree that hate speech should not be permissible, but if the people in power are the ones who are defining what hate speech is, then how is that not a form of censorship?
Gretel?
Well, I'd just raise a question probably to my intelligent side. Who should define it? I mean, really, I guess in many of these things it's do unto others as you would have them do unto you. How would you like to be treated? What would you like the outcome to be? But what are the parameters for you at Penn?
One interesting thing that comes up again and again in Penn cases is when governments want to malign someone, they call them a terrorist. I spoke before about Anna Politkovskaya. When she went to Chechnya, she blew the whistle on this. I mean, the Russian troops were committing appalling crimes and they got away with it time and time again because they said, oh, they're terrorists. They're actually women and children, innocent people. And this comes up again and again. That case I mentioned, another case I mentioned, Recep Zorakoglu, the courageous Turkish publisher, he was imprisoned under a charge of being a terrorist, when in actual fact he was defending the rights of Kurds. to express their views and to speak their language. And he documents case after case after case of human rights abuses and abuses of this kind in Turkey. But again and again, you bring up this bogey of being a terrorist. And I think it's a good illustration of the issues you bring up in your question.
Michael Gawenda.
Can I be heard?
Yep.
I actually don't think what Arnold said has anything to do with the question. The question was, who in our society defines what is hate speech, or in other words, what is unacceptable speech? And the fact is that it's very hard. What defines it is what, in the end, legislation. Under the racial vilification legislation, as interpreted by judges and lawyers, who I don't necessarily think I necessarily trust to come up with interpretations that meet what I think ought to be the standard for what is hate speech. And in many ways, it's about what I was trying to say before. And by the way, Julian, flattery like that will get you nowhere. All of that flattery was designed to get you a result. None of it was sincere. Not a single word of it was sincere. And I've got a right, I've got the free speech to be able to say that. But the fact is that, you know, what is hate speech for some people is acceptable speech for other people. And it all depends where you're coming from. Some people who, for instance, would absolutely, absolutely be appalled by people who said things about, I don't know, about Aboriginal people that were clearly prejudiced, would support the right, for instance, of David Irving to say whatever he wanted to say about the Jews and the Holocaust. Now, why is that? One of the reasons why that is because one group are seen as being powerless and another group are seen as having the power to be able to respond. Now, I think these are complicated issues, but the fact is that in our society, in the main, we don't really believe in free speech.
Okay, I'll take Catherine, and then I'm going to come back to the audience and then draw Marcia in.
There's a big issue in our society about offence, which is something which intrigues me. The kind of assumption by some people that just because they're offended means that they're right. Some people are offended by same-sex marriage, you know, asylum seekers getting humane treatment in Australia, women having fertility control over their own bodies, and that is something that we need to look very closely at, the empty vessels that are making the most noise. There's people like Jim Wallace from the Australian Christian Lobby who is often called, you know, a powerful and influential figure, yet he actually represents less people who are actually in this room. And that's according to people from, you know, from Christian churches. They say he doesn't represent us. And I say, why don't you speak up a bit louder about the fact that he doesn't speak for you? Because he seems to be doing a lot of your dirty work, making a lot of noise about things like, you know, HIV awareness campaigns and things like that. As soon as there's something like that goes up, he and his little minions out there who've got no time on their hands, but they've been allowed to have a computer, just let a bomb, petition bomb, and send out emails, having a very amplified voice in our community. And that's something that we really have to look at very closely. Who is saying what and what is their vested interest?
Okay, let's just take a few comments from the floor. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name's Andrew. As a former sexuality officer at the University of Canberra, I actually noticed that there was a lot of people coming to me with issues to do with sexuality and religious persecution. And I find that people should have the right to come out as gay, lesbian, transgendered, even having a political stance without the ability to make sure that common decency and human rights and respect is actually afforded to all parties.
Thank you. And across here, your name, sir?
Maurice Alexander. I supported the affirmative when I was coming in, and I still support the affirmative, despite my learned friend Julian's brilliant take on the situation. I think the reason I support the affirmative still is I think behind this debate there's a really important thing going on in Australia at the moment, and that's to do with the freedom of press that comes from the American Constitution to Australia and the way that the press in Australia has managed to dominate the whole political situation and turn it into something that is completely undemocratic. Catherine seems to have pointed this out very well when she says the people that can get a voice are very limited to a particular group, and the people that don't get a voice are the majority of people. I'm thoroughly in agreement with the slogan of the 1% versus the 99, and I think that what we need to realise in Australia is that our politics has been badly affected, and we should be doing something about not just Murdoch, but the whole idea that a free press can rule the country through its moneyed backers.
Okay. Marcia. As has been noted by a few people, Julian Burnside actually lauded you as a person who defends and exemplifies freedom of speech by what you've done. So what are you going... I want to know what you would say in response to him, apart from the fact that those were shallow compliments. Do you... What is the thing that you are saying is not just that... Because I think you take it that free speech is important, but what is more important then that makes freedom of speech overvalued in comparison to what?
Well, look, embedded in the intellectual tradition of freedom of speech, as it is discussed in Australia and, you know, as it might be manifest in Australia, is the idea of a balance. That is, a balance between the right to freedom of expression as against the harm that expression might cause to others. And so, you know, the point is that there's a rhetoric of free speech, and, you know, the man from Sunbury thought that I was criticising the Constitution. I was merely making, you know, a factual statement. Our Constitution doesn't provide a right to freedom of speech. Some people say it's implied. But if it is not in the Constitution, but there are laws that say that you can't do this and you can't do that in relation to how you speak and what you say, then therefore the law assumes the existence of free speech. So actually, you know, what we have in Australia is a negative acknowledgement of a freedom of speech in the fact that our speech is limited in various ways in the law. Now, freedom of speech can only exist if there is a set of laws, and as I say, ours are negative, because, you know, our right to... the way that we assess freedom of speech must be predictable, yeah? It must be based on principles, and one of them, of course, is... to avoid doing harm to others. So I think to avoid doing harm to others has priority over the right to freedom of speech or the right to freedom of information or other rights. So so just to give you an example.
So just to ask, to be clear.
Okay.
When you say to avoid doing harm to others is to be valued more than freedom of speech, do you mean by that causing offence to others, or do you have something more significant in mind as to what constitutes harm?
Have something more significant in mind. I'm thinking, for instance, of the radio broadcast in Rwanda that started the genocide, for example.
Okay. Next person here, please.
My name's Robert. I think this whole debate has basically been probably started off by the Andrew Bolt court case, where Andrew Bolt has basically said playing the race card should be a legitimate right. And I think the Liberal Party, since 1996, when John Howard was elected, has been very subtly and very cunningly trying to manipulate Australian society into a more bigoted society, using people like Andrew Bolt to do their dirty work while their politicians play the dignified statesman. Examples, of course, of Tony Abbott getting up on an Australia Day and saying how much Australians respect Aboriginals while encouraging Andrew Bolt to go keep going for the good of the nation. And Andrew, of course, tells his right viewers and the people that listen to him as virtually treat Aboriginal views of Aboriginal people with contempt. And no country has ever made itself more democratic by making itself more racist.
Okay, thank you. What I'm going to do is take last few speakers and then we're going to move to the vote. So, final three speakers. Yes.
Hi, my name's Maddie Atwood and I admire Julian in that I would like to also be a human rights lawyer as my profession. But I completely agree with Michael's point on that I'm both for and against the motion in that I don't think true freedom of speech has been realised in Australia. In the sense that in the case of Andrew Bolt, as that seems to be a common theme, his articles were terrible in what they said and the factual errors, but isn't freedom of speech, he should, be it in poor taste, be allowed to have those opinions, in that you need to balance out sort of the morals and ethics in society, and that you as a person can decide based on both the for and against the arguments or racism as we've seen in a typical debate.
Okay, thank you. Next gentleman.
Hello, my name's Martin Spencer. I'm the president of the Graduate Student Association at the University of Melbourne. I'm surprised in this debate so far that the issue of our right to hear has not come up. When someone is indicted for hate speech crime, the court actually interferes with my right to hear what they have to say, and in particular, where to direct my attacks against their shoddy, foolish beliefs, and also our ability to rehearse the arguments against those kind of beliefs that they're expressing.
Okay, and I hope that this will be picked up as we come back in some closing remarks. And yes, final speaker from the floor.
My name is Barbara Hadkinson.
And
I have a question, and I believe that the words insult, humiliate, offend or intimidate are those in the Racial Discrimination Act, and I have heard that people are wishing one or more of those words to be deleted. Do the panels have anything to say on what should be deleted and what should not?
Okay. And so where is it? Here, thank you.
Hi, my name is Shakira Hussain and I am for the motion, except that I disagree with Catherine Deneve and agree with Julian Burnside, so I'm not sure where that puts me. But yeah, I'm interested in why the perception that free speech is fragile and under threat within Australian society is touted, I think, as a coded way of saying that certain elements within our society have become too powerful. And Indigenous community being one of them, and Marcia Langton has spoken to that, and the other one being mine, which is the Muslim community. You know, that we have become too powerful and we are limiting the ability of other Australians to speak. And so I don't like the way that the idea of free speech under threat is used as sort of scaremongering and a coded way of, as I said, saying that some people have become too powerful. Google's wrong about Voltaire, by the way, but I won't go into that, just Google it.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your contribution. What we're going to do now is two things. One is that you'll see ballot boxes will circulate and it'll give you an opportunity to vote for, against, or if you're undecided, leave your tickets together. This will be taking place as you're hearing the speakers sum up for 2 minutes each. Now, they may respond to a comment you've made, answer a question, or add some additional point. As you vote, you've got to think, are you persuaded by the affirmative that says, yes, free speech may be important, but it's overvalued in comparison to other things? Or are you persuaded by the arguments of the negative that say, of course there should be some limits to free speech, but it's impossible to overvalue it given its centrality to political debate, expression of ideas and a number of other things? Marcia Langton, you have 2 minutes to make some concluding remarks. Your time begins now.
Thank you, Simon. There was a case some years ago in Melbourne involving a Burmese refugee. The immigration official wrote on her file, Ooga Booga, and then her lawyer took the case to court, and I actually forget the grounds, but in any case, of course, part of the argument was that she had not been treated fairly by the Department of Immigration and that there was racism in her treatment, and the evidence for that was the scribble, Ooga Booga, written against her name on the file. I read the judge's decision, and with each word or phrase or sentence, I Googled it to see where he'd got these opinions from. And everything he said was taken from an ordinary search of Google. So his entire judgment was just cut and paste from Google. And you know, most of it was wrong. And I've always felt very bad about that Burmese refugee because she didn't get a fair hearing. And I think her case should have been appealed again. And I don't know why her lawyers didn't, and she was deported. You know, so there you have, you know, an official of government writing on somebody's file, Ooga Booga. Well, we all know what that means. You know, I know what it means, and you know, them's fighting words. Call me Ooga Booga to my face and see what happens. So there's a case of a distinct harm done to a person, and you know, freedom of expression was actually cited in this case, and it, you know, the argument was complete and utter rubbish. So that's where I'll leave it. Thank you, Simon.
I'd like to use this little amount of time I've got available to take a very different tack. And I think it's got a relevance to a number of the comments that have come up from the audience, and that is, how do you create the situation where you can give a voice to the voiceless? It's something that came home to me most dramatically in 2001 during the Tampa affair, when you had the Tampa offshore. Now, I don't know if you remember, the Tampa was like a red hull on the horizon. It wasn't allowed to go into Flying Fish Cove and land on Christmas Island. And on express orders from Canberra, no journalist or photographer was allowed to go near that boat. So what you had were photographs taken through a telephoto lens, and what you saw was a horde of people. It was a deliberate policy, and those that instituted it knew exactly what they were doing. They were dehumanizing, and they were robbing these people of their humanity. So I think this is a whole other area of this debate we haven't touched on, and this is the way in which many people's voices, especially those that are not often heard, are not heard deliberately through the powerful curtailing their voices. But a number of years ago, between 2009 and 2011, I ran a number of workshops for Black Saturday bushfire survivors, this was an attempt to allow them to tell their own stories. And so we'd spend a number of hours once a week in six different locations, and they they were encouraged to express their own stories. And one day one of the participants came up to me and said, look, this is far more powerful than counselling. And I said, why is this far more powerful than counselling? She said, because when I'm counselled, I feel like a victim. But when I write my own stories, I'm in charge. I'm an author. I'm the authority on my own story. So I just wanted to end on this different note. How do we encourage the voiceless to be heard? Thank you.
Catherine Deveny.
I just want to talk about definitions for a moment. There's no right to see, to hear, to smell, or right to grow hair. We take that as a given. So the mere fact that there's even the term, the right to free speech, proves unequivocally that all we have is an illusion of free speech for all. Some people can say some things some of the times without negative consequences. There are self-appointed bodies that issue it, define the parameters of it, and retract it to suit their objectives. To be given the permission indicates that freedom of speech is not a born right. Therefore, the notion that it exists proves that it's overrated. And may I suggest further that the illusion of free speech is like cheese to mice, to flush out the dissenters so they can be punished, silenced, and used as human piñatas in order to limit free speech with the method kill one, scare a thousand.
Gretel, Killeen.
It's interesting that really both sides here are arguing that we need to value free speech more highly, but it does raise the question in my mind, because we've been talking about others and them, but have you actually looked at your own responsibility to express your thoughts, your political thoughts, your opinions in the workplace? One of the things that happens in any society is that we inhibit our self-expression because we fear alienation. So if you're brave enough to actually express your situation, it will allow others to voice theirs as well. So I would suggest that it is a responsibility, not just to be talking about journalists, for example, but yourself. What truths are you telling, and how are you experiencing freedom of speech? I would also just, I was talking to a friend before I came here, telling her the subject, and she told me that she employed freedom of speech on her wedding day. She decided to break free of tradition, and she wouldn't have the wedding march walking down the aisle. She would have the theme song from The Lion King, which is something like, forgive the notes, can you feel the love tonight? Beautiful. She got there at the end of the aisle ready to walk down, and someone played the wrong track on the CD. And it came out, so be careful how you use it.
I think you're the first person ever to have sung at one of these debates, so well done. Michael, Gawenda.
Well, that was very amusing. But totally irrelevant. Very amusing, but totally irrelevant. The fact is this, that we have a debate in this country, most of you would know about it, about whether we ought to have a Bill of Rights. And one of the freedoms, one of the rights that would be in this Bill of Rights is the right to freedom of expression. On the left and the right, there are opponents of this bill for various reasons, for different reasons. But I can guarantee you we will not have a Bill of Rights, not in my lifetime, not in your lifetime, because basically those in power and us, we don't really believe in free speech. If we had a First Amendment in Australia, there are things that we could write and say that we can't say at the moment. There are things that I, as a journalist, knew when I was a journalist and an editor that I couldn't publish because the defamation laws were so bloody tight and ridiculous that they couldn't be published. You know, someone once said that in Australia you could never have had the Watergate scandal exposed because we simply would have been shut down by threats of defamation. And it's true. We don't have free speech rights. When I was in America, there were awful protests by people who are fundamentalist Christians at the funerals of soldiers coming back from Iraq. They were protesting about the military that allowed gays and lesbians to be in the military. And they had placards up saying, "Rot in hell," to these soldiers. The case was taken to court. And the people who took the case, those grieving relatives and friends, lost the case. And they lost the case on the First Amendment rights, that these dirtbags had a right to stand on the footpath and scream these obscenities. Now, that's true free speech. Do you support that?
Can I ask you, the vote's been counted, so it doesn't affect...
Oh, what a pity. Hold back your votes.
If somebody proposed a First Amendment right of that kind in Australia, would you oppose it on that basis?
No, I'd support it.
You'd support it. Your argument is you'd support it, but you don't think we have the stomach for it?
Yeah.
Right. Julian Burnside.
Why am I not surprised that Michael would support a First Amendment? Can I say a couple of things? First of all, it's your first time ever. I've been called an old seducer, and I'm wondering which part of it troubles me more.
What if I just said... I might have said just experience.
Second, Michael, I wasn't being shallow. I was being sincere. I do actually admire all of you for what you've done for free speech. Third, I think that one of the difficulties that's permeated the debate, and especially some of the questions, is that in Australia we do not adequately value free speech. We underrate it very significantly. The part of the problem is... In deciding or distinguishing between the value of free speech on one hand as a value and the difficulty of finding limits to free speech on the other hand. It is a difficult task and the two can get mixed up and we heard plenty of that today. An example of the need for the public to value free speech came, and Arnold just reminded me of this, when he referred to the Tampa. Of course, the people on Tampa couldn't speak for themselves. I was very happy to go to court and speak on their behalf. That is the only time in my career I have received death threats. Think about that. There's a measure of how highly we value free speech, that you get death threats for speaking up for people who plainly cannot do anything to save themselves. Now, what we need to do is to value free speech more highly than we do. We have to recognise that some free speech will be unpopular and to distinguish between what's unpopular and what is damaging or dangerous or dishonest. And if we can learn to value free speech and to distinguish between those aspects of free speech which should be allowed and those aspects which should be limited for the greater good, then finally we will have genuine free speech in this country which we will all admire. And to take up Catherine's point, she says it's an illusion. Well, if free speech is an illusion in this country, then plainly it is underrated.
Now I'm going to put the same question I put to Michael Gawenda because... you argued during your actual speech that anything which crossed the line in the way that Marcia was suggesting some things do was not truly free speech, that it was something else. So let's suppose now that there was a First Amendment being proposed for Australia of an American kind, which would allow things to be said which are hurtful, damaging and untrue. Would you oppose it?
I don't think the First Amendment right in America permits defamatory remarks. So, you know, we start from a false premise.
Okay, what about hurtful then, at least?
Hurtful within limits, within limits. Now, I mean, as I said, the tricky bit is deciding where the limits are to be drawn. That's ultimately going to be a reflection of community attitudes as interpreted by judges. And in order to set those limits in a way which is sensible and sensitive, you need a community which actually values free speech for what it is and understands how the limits are to be set.
Okay. Well, look, the vote will... Yes, please applaud everyone. Your votes will have been tallied, but before I get them, just let me express some thanks to our partners in Melbourne here, the Wheeler Centre, who put on these magnificent events, the staff and management of the Melbourne Town Hall, a fantastic venue, the volunteers who've conducted the ballot the editor and management of The Age, who've been stimulating the debates around these topics for so long, and to the Mayor, Aldermen and officers of the City of Melbourne who help support these debates, and of course to our supporters, AMP, who've helped to sustain this venture. Before I even get the votes, depending, so that it doesn't matter who's won, would you please join with me though in thanking our marvellous panel of speakers, Marcia Langton, Arnold Zable, Catherine Deveny, Gretel Killeen, Michael Gawenda and Julian Burnside. Okay, before the poll was taken, this is how the figures lay. For the motion, 25.2%. Against the motion, 59.9%. And don't know, 14.9%, which is quite small actually for these things. Usually it's a much larger one. After the poll, don't know had just reduced a tiny amount to 12%. But the for side had reduced to 16.3%, giving the against side 71.7% and therefore victory in the debate. Ladies and gentlemen, the next debate is on the 4th of July. The topic is that foreign aid is a waste of money. Please do make sure that you look up that and come along. If you've got bits and pieces of paper on your chairs, please take that with you. But apart from that, thanks to everybody who came along, and I declare the debate closed. Good evening.